So the topic is connected finance reference architecture. So this is an exercise that we did for a while working on customers with different domains. We identified set of reference architectures like health, government, and then finance. So here the idea to walk you through the reference architecture that we identified for the financial sector. So before jump into the architecture, let's look at the challenges that we have. The first thing is mobility. Even financial sector, everyone doing their day-to-day financial activities using mobiles and then smart devices. So whatever the systems and then the data that we have should be able to facilitate the mobility. So that is one challenge that we see in the financial sector. Then the second thing is location, like not like earlier days that you will stick to one bank or a financial institute. We should be able to access our financial information and do whatever the transactions wherever we are, and people are on the road most of the time, so location is an issue. Then we are not stick to one financial institute, because I might be dealing with a couple of financial institutes, but based on the location as well as the need, I will go to a different financial institute, but these institutes should be communicate with each other and then share the information. So the connectivity in between different institutes is another challenge that we see. Then the social stuff, because even social features are required with financial applications. As example, like when we get a check today, I can quickly take a picture and then upload it, and then I can deposit my check. Like that, a lot of the social features are associated with the financial domain as well. So that's another challenge that we see as technical people. And then the virtual payments, because there are a lot of virtual payments happening and all the backend systems should be supported, the current virtual payments as well as the new virtual payments coming to the market. Then the next thing is mobile payments, because everybody talking about mobile payments, and then a lot of people using mobile payments in different transactions. So whatever the systems that we build should be able to cater the current mobile payments as well as the new devices that will come in future. Not only devices, it can be sensors as well. And if you look at the backend or the ecosystem behind this mobile payments, it's not that simple. It has to integrate it with many systems, as well as the integration has to be secured, because you are doing a financial transaction, as well as it has to build on the reliability, because the transactions that you send, we have to make sure it goes to the backend systems and update whatever the backend banking systems that we have. Then if you look at the next generation of financial infrastructure, so this is a diagram that I picked. So the if you look at it connects with all the backend systems that we have, the day-to-day operations like HR systems and then CRM systems, so on and so forth, as well as the financial related applications that coming from the old world, and then a lot of new systems that comes into the picture. As well as there are a lot of business needs that you need, business user needs that you need to provide dashboards, you need to provide reports, so you need to take the data from the current data repositories and then provide it as a format that these business users are looking for. So the reporting, monitoring, and then management is kind of a need. And then you will get a big data store with a different type of financial data formats coming from the old world as well as the new applications that you are developing. So you need to have some kind of master data management, then ETL type of solutions in built on top of the data that you have. And then different type of functionalities, like normal day-to-day banking functionalities, as well as the call center type of functionalities, and then the kind of virtual payment, and then credit card payments, payment gateways, all these things are connected with the central ecosystem, because most of these things happen in a batch mode in the old world, but today it's more real-time, and everything connected with the these type of an architecture. then the connectivity is the key thing because you need to connect with these different systems. So how these things are connected. So first thing is the services and APIs. So that's what we do. We try to expose all the backend banking functionality as a service, and then services are exposed as APIs to consume. Because in the modern world, we tell services got the implementation, but it's not consumable. The APIs are the consumable unit that you expose the services as an API. So you need to get the services and API. And there are a lot of financial-related protocols that your connectivity or the integration layer should support. Especially, I took an example, FIX, because FIX is kind of a common thing in the financial sector. And then subset of that, like FPML, FIXML type of financial protocols. And then the most of the backend systems are working with the financial protocols, but the modern applications and the systems that you are bringing using the open standards like HTTP, JMS, MQP, MQTT type of standards. So you need to bridge the financial protocols to the open protocols. Then you can't avoid cloud because there are a lot of cloud applications that supports to have some kind of business functionalities. So you need to connect your internal stuff with the cloud, and you should have set of cloud connectors. And all the connectivity has to be secured because you need to secure, have a proper secured way of communicating and then sharing messages across different systems. Then you might be using different security standards, like backend might be secured using Kerberos or AWS Security, but your frontend might be using OAuth or SAML type of security standards. So you need to bridge the security in between different systems. And then the integration is primarily with build on top of enterprise integration patterns and message exchange patterns. So whatever the technology or the architecture that you are bringing should support the enterprise integration patterns as well as message exchange patterns like request response or publish and subscribe type of message exchange patterns. Then the as an example, like connectivity using the financial protocol, so I took example from our enterprise service bus that you can have a fixed initiator connect with the ESB, and then it act as a fixed acceptor, and then you can send the messages to a fixed engine by using a fixed initiator and then establish a communication in between the system and the your connectivity layer. So that is one example that I took from that. And then the bridging to the open protocols. Now, you get the information from FIX, but you need to call a backend service that wrote in SOAP. So what you can do, get the FIX transport and then convert the FIX message into XML infoset and then wrap it inside the SOAP message and use HTTP as a transport and send it to the backend. That you don't need to do anything, that it will convert the FIX message by using a XML message builder into XML infoset. If you need to do any transformation because your backend system might need the message in a specific scheme, so you can put a transformation logic and then get it transformed. So that's how you can do the protocol bridging. And then the another example, the first example basically convert FIX to HTTP. In this example, the FIX can convert into a protocol like AMQP because AMQP has become another popular protocol in the financial sector. So you can easily convert the FIX message into the AMQP and then call AMQP broker. And then the subsystems can be subscribed into the AMQP broker and then take these messages out from that. So that's another use case. Then the routing, because you might need to route the messages. So in this example, I took like based on the symbol, it will send the messages to different trading flows. Like that, it can be a header or it can be a value in the message body. You can do header-based routing as well as you can do the payload or the message-based routing as well. And then route them into different service platforms or different trading flows. You can even have kind of conditional stuff. You can have static routing rules or you can have dynamic routing rules by using different rule sets in the integration layer. Then the unification, because you might be communicating using a specific financial protocol version, but internally you might have a different financial protocol. So you need to bridge different versions, so that can be done as well by using the mediation. And it's really helpful to have a unification internally and then plug different versions externally and use the communication. Then if you summarize the connectivity, like you will get different systems and subsystems in two sections and then different protocols. And this mediation layer can use routing, smart routing, transformation, and then even you can persist, because you might need to persist the messages in between, like all the orders as well as execution reports can be persisted by using this, because this gateway pattern is really useful that every transaction will go through the same gateway layer. If you look at logical, it's a single gateway, but if you look at in the deployment, it can be multiple gateways based on your system load that you will deploy. So everything goes through the same gateway, so you can persist it, as well as if you want to monitor, then it's easy to monitor because you can capture everything from this gateway layer. So that's one advantage of this gateway of gateways pattern that we use in the integration. Then the EDA, or the event-driven architecture, so it's kind of very useful in financial sector. So EDA started with PubSub, so the guy who invented PubSub is sitting over there, Sean Methan, who's the co-founder of TIBCO, now working as the vice president of platform evangelism in WSO2. So it started with PubSub, and then it enhanced the architecture into an event-driven thing. But the primary concept is the people publish events, and then other people come and subscribe. So if you want to have a proper loosely coupled architecture, as well as a connectivity layer that you can change based on the dynamics of your business, like based on the day. Now, in this example, I am using the symbols as the subscription or the topic for these subscriptions. And you can have a way of rearranging your topics, because nothing is tightly coupled, everything is loosely coupled based on the subscription. So you can create your topic hierarchy on daily basis and then get the subscribers to subscribe for the interesting events that they are interested. So that way the processing of different units are really efficient, because they will only accept the messages that they are interested, as well as you can bring new systems into the system without affecting other systems, because a system will come and then start subscribing for a set of messages and it will start processing. And if we want to send these messages back to the system, it will send the messages to an existing topic, or it will create a new topic and use it. So this is really useful in financial architectures too. Make it event-driven, as well as it will provide a more kind of a real-time thing, because you are not requesting the messages. Whenever the message is generated in the systems and subsystems, it will deliver to the relevant subscribers. So it's kind of a very good pattern. And then we support the EDA heavily. And yesterday, John did a detailed session on EDA reference architecture, how the WSO2 platform can support it. So it's a very useful pattern for you. Then you need the connectors, as I explained. So we have a connector architecture that you can bridge from your on-premise to cloud in a secured way. And then the challenge here, different type of cloud providers, they have their own message protocols and then own security protocols. So that's where the connectors will help you. Without building everything from scratch, you can take the connector, configure it, and then go to cloud and get the information back, as well as you can send your information to the cloud and update the data set as well. Then the hybrid deployment, because this is very useful. You might have limitations, because you can't move your data or some of your processors to the cloud. You might have to keep it in your data centers. I think especially in Europe, there are regulations that you can't move data from some locations, so you have to keep it locally. So in a situation like that, you can use the hybrid deployments, and we support it, that you run some of the processors and data in your data center and then move move some of the processors into the cloud and then have a proper scalable architecture for those processors and bridge the cloud and your data center using a secure channel. Another pattern that is really useful for you while you are building these type of architectures. And as I explained earlier, this gateway pattern is very useful because everything goes through some set of gateways. Based on that, you can put the analytics. So I'm using the old version, like the business activity monitor. It will become the data analytics server in future. So you can plug our analytical engine, or you, if you have an analytical framework, then you can start getting events to that analytical framework from these gateways that we have, event publishers that we can publish to different type of analytical frameworks. So that is one way, like you can get the events from the data or the event publishers, or you can stick to the logs, because there's a common way that people monitor by listening to logs. So we provide syslogs that you can use. And all these gateways support the standard called JMX, that standard Java standard to monitor servers. So there are multiple MBNs available that provide different statistics. You can subscribe for the JMX beans and then get the statistics out of that as well. So multiple options that we have. And the data publisher layer is extensible, that you can even write a new data publisher and put it there, so it will start pushing events for to your systems. Then the external and internal integration, like it's a little bit complicated, but because of different systems, use different protocols, security standards, and then different data models. So in our architecture, we have the necessary components that you can build a connectivity in between different systems that use the ESP, data services server, or message broker for data publishing. Based on your integration need, we can recommend you what are the components that you need to build such an integration layer. And that's where the entire platform comes into the picture, because you can't just use the ESB and build the entire integration. You might need the rest of the components. Like if you have a kind of orchestration requirement, if the orchestration is stateless and then short running, performance critical, you can use the ESB. But if your orchestration logic is long running and stateful, you need some kind of a persistency maintained, then the business process server is the best option. Like that, based on your integration need, you can pick the relevant component from the architecture and use it. And then we have the complete cloud architecture as well. As I explained, cloud has become a necessity. So you can build cloud architecture using the cloud platform that we provide as a private platform as a service for you, or you can utilize the public cloud or the public platform as a service. But when we look at the financial sector, public cloud might be not an option, because you might need to keep your information private for you. So the private cloud running in a local data center, or a private cloud hosted in a public interface, a public hosting place like Amazon or Rackspace might be really useful for you. Then this is a reference architecture that we identified by working with many customers, how the modern business requirements map into a financial reference architecture. You can see the data layer and then the identity layer. Then there are a lot of cloud, financial clouds that you can use the private PaaS, and then the dashboard specifically on your the left-hand side that you can see. So you can use the user engagement server and build all these analytical needs. And then the data that you store, the statistics data that you store, you can process real-time using the complex event processor, and then near real-time using the business activity monitor, and then get all the statistics out. And the centrally you see the event hub, or the message broker, that you can use different protocols like JMS, MQP, MQTT. Based on your need, you can pick the protocol and do the message brokering there. And then the workflows are handled by the business process server, like a BPL engine that you can use BPL, as well as if there are any human interactions, you can use WS human task or the BPL for people type of specifications. And then the data layer integrated using the data services server. And if you are writing some services, you can use the application server to write services using different service writing standards like JAX-WS, JAX-RS, AXIS2, and then even pure Java objects like that. And then you can expose your financial API using the API manager, and ESB act as the core integration among these different components in this architecture. So you don't need to bring everything. There can be stuff that exists in your architecture, but you should do identify the missing pieces and bring it to the new architecture that you are looking at. So as a summary, that there are different protocol support required, like fix AMQP, MQTT type of stuff. And then your solution should be scalable, and high availability should be there, because we need to make sure that we guarantee the messages. And then it has to be real time in today's customer needs. And then the guaranteed delivery, and then cloud and hybrid deployment come into the picture. And you need the security heavily based on the security architecture. And everything has to be API driven, because we can't go back and then do the mistakes that we did in the early SO architectures. And then another thing that we see with most of the financial institutes, they build a platform as a service, like integration platform as a service, API platform as a service, and then application platform as a service, and then provide the internal developers to do the integration as well as application development on these platforms that you build. So that way you can properly secure, as well as you can make it more template or standard driven, so developers will stick to those standards and build these applications and then have proper application lifecycle management as well. And then the componentization and handler driven architecture, because you might need to add new features, like you might need to bring proprietary protocols and then your own way of doing things into this framework, so you can use the componentized architecture and then make the things change. And then the future is about device management and IoT, so that's what John Mathan going to do next, to talk about how IoT connect with the financial sector and use it in your financial architecture.